So now we are going to find the Pareto efficient allocation in consumption exchange problem of two consumers. However, to proceed step by step, we will start from a concept called core. So first we'll try to find what is called core of an exchange. The reason is very simple. The reason is that within that core, we will go for the Pareto efficient points. All right. So the idea is to start with an arbitrary point. Let's say this arbitrary point, E, where E is the initial endowment. Okay. And since from the knowledge of consumer behavior, we know that the indifference map of both of these individuals are dense, we can always find two ICs which satisfies two criteria. Number one is that each of them passes through E. So this is the IC of individual A, and this is the IC of individual B. So you have maintained our assumption stated earlier that B's IC is convex to the origin of B and A's IC is convex to the origin of A. Now, this is our point E. Okay. And what we are trying to find here? We are trying to find that if we can have Pareto improvement from this point E. Now, as you can think that since the utility increases for B in this direction, right? So in this direction, utility of B increases, and in this direction, utility of A increases. If we can move along either this IC, let's say if we move along this IC of UB, we'll name it UB1. So if we move along UB1, then utility of B remains intact. Whereas utility of A increases, right? So that means if we move in this direction along UB, we will have Pareto improvement. We will have Pareto improvement. And the same reason leads us that we can also move in this direction, right? So here also, if we move along UA, we can make B better off without making A worse off. So in movement in this direction, that also goes for Pareto improvement. So this is also a room for Pareto improvement. Okay. Now, since all the ICs of, let's say, B are convex to the origin of B, so you can imagine ICs of this kind, right? So there will be some IC which goes like this. And there will be some IC which will goes like this. And as we move along, we'll be increasing B's utility at this point and then further increasing at this point. At the point where keeping A's utility unchanged, we can increase B's utility to the maximum amount possible is this point. So what is the speciality of this point? Let's say this point is M1. So what is the speciality of M1? So at M1, or M1 is the leftmost point at which we have kept A's utility intact while increasing B's utility, right? So at M1, we have exhausted the room for Pareto improvement. So at M1, we have exhausted room for Pareto improvement. And why we are saying that we have exhausted the room for Pareto improvement? Why we are saying exhausted? We are saying exhausted because now if we take a point further left, let's say at this point, okay, if we choose this point, then suddenly the utility of A will decrease, right? Okay, so let us take this point as, let's say this point, let us name this point as some C. So at C, utility of B increases at the cost of utility of A, correct? And that kind of a movement is not Pareto improvement. So our room for Pareto improvement is getting exhausted at M1. And also, if we apply the same line of reasoning while moving on the indifference curve of B, that is UB1, then we'll find some kind of a, let's say, a point like this M2, where again, we will have exhausted the room for Pareto improvement. And going by the same argument, if we take a point right on right of M2, then the utility of A will be increased at the cost of utility of B. So this means that beyond M1 and M2 and outside this region, okay, so this region which looks like a lens, so outside this region, what will happen? Either A or B will block. So either A or B will block the allocation. At least one of them will say that, no, I don't want it. Or at least given the idea of Pareto improvement. All right. So that means that if we start from E, then given this point, let's say if this is F, then asking for Pareto improvement, the only region we can stay within is this lens, this region, right? Which looks like a lens. And in this region, all the points in the region between M1, M2, E and F, all the points are making certain Pareto improvement over E, excluding F, obviously. So excluding F from E, all the points within this region are making some Pareto improvement. And because they are making Pareto improvement, this set includes, more efficient point, let's say. Okay. At least they are efficient in sense of more efficient than E in sense of Pareto. Now, this region is called core. So this region is called a core. So now let us look at the definition of core. So what is a core? Core is the set of allocations which nobody objects. Okay, so here what is the core? A region between M1, M2, E and F. That is our core. Now, while constructing the core, we passed or we crossed over the idea of equilibrium or efficient point. You see, the maximum improvement that you can have on the utility of B given the utility of A is at the point M1, and the vice versa occurs at M2. And what is the speciality of M1 and M2? So the speciality of M1 and M2 is that at both of these two points, two ICs are tangent. Correct? Okay. So at both M1 and M2, these two ICs are tangent to each other. And that gives us an idea of how far we can go. But as I said, that all the points within this set are Pareto efficient in that sense. Note that we can have a tangency here also, or we can have a tangency here also. Okay? I'm not naming them, but as you can see, that there can be tangent here also. And then this point, these two points, we have a different kind of Pareto improvement. The improvement is that in these two points, the utility of both of them has increased. Okay. So they are the inefficient points, and these two are also the efficient points, which tells us that given an endowment like E, we can have a host of Pareto efficient allocations. Okay. And where will we move? That depends on a lot of things. Okay. So let us then move into what we call a contract curve. So just to sum it up, we have started from an initial endowment, and we have seen that core of an exchange economy gives us the room within which we can have our Pareto improvement. And also have seen that the border points are somehow characterized by this M1 and M2, where these two ICs are becoming tangent. All right. And these two are solutions of a problem where we are trying to say at M1, we are trying to maximize B's utility given A's utility. But we also see that in within the core, we have several other points where this tangential criteria is satisfied, right? Where at these two points also, if we want to move, then there will be problem. For example, when we reach, let's say, if I talk about this, when we reach M1, right? At M1, you see, I can move beyond M1 above in this direction also I can move, but if I move in this direction, given fixed utility of A, the utility of B will decrease. So there is no point. B will block the movement towards this direction. But compared to E, this is Pareto efficient, and compared to Pareto improvement, and compared to E, this point is also a Pareto improvement, right? But if we start from a point like M1 or a point like M2, then we do not have any room for Pareto improvement. Okay. So this gives us an idea of what we are trying to find. Now, as we also showed that we can have points like this within the core where this tangential criteria is satisfied. Okay. Now, given there are several Pareto efficient points, we will move into something called a contract curve. So what is a contract curve? A contract curve is the locus of Pareto efficient allocations. Okay, so just as we observed that there can be several Pareto efficient allocation, we'll be interested in finding the locus, and that locus is called contract curve. Now we will have a diagram where we will draw the contract curve. Let me first say that here the shape of the contract curve that I'll choose is just an arbitrary choice. The exact shape or position of the contract curve has to be found mathematically. Diagrammatically, it is possible if the ICs are quite simple in nature. Okay, so let's just say that the contract curve looks like, the contract curve looks like this. As we saw that on the contract curve, utility of ICs of each and every individual must be tangent to each other. Okay, so when you're moving from OA to OB, higher ICs are signifying higher utility for A, and the reverse case is true for B. So that's why 1, 2, 3 in this direction, and for B, 1, 2, 3 in this direction. So all these 3 points, let's say following our earlier notation M1, M2, and M3, each of them, so each is Pareto efficient. Why? Because given we start at M1. Given we start at M1, there is no room for Pareto improvement. But if we had started from any other point, then we would have reached any one point on this contract curve. All right? Okay, so that's how we draw a contract curve. But as I said, that without the mathematical apparatus, I cannot find the exact shape of the contract curve unless it is very simple. Anyways, now one of the important thing is that, you see, when we understood core, we started with an initial endowment, and then we looked at the process of how to make Pareto improvement. But while drawing the contract curve, we never mentioned any initial point here. Now that says something. First of all, what it says is that if you want to draw a contract curve, then drawing the contract curve or finding its shape, it is independent of the initial allocation. Okay? Okay. So, regarding the role of initial endowment, we must say two very important things. Number one is, what you just said, that position and shape of contract curve does not depend on initial endowment. Okay, so does not depend on initial endowment. That is the first important thing. However, given why then we are talking about initial endowment, because on initial endowment, there are some things which do depend. So what are those things? First is this, given a problem, if you want to find a specific solution. So if my question is this, exactly which point will we reach? See, by now you have understood that we will always reach a point on the contract curve. But if I ask this, exactly which point will we reach? Then to answer this question, we need the initial endowment. Okay. Without that, we cannot answer this point. And this is very important. Number two, second question is, you see, given initial endowments allow us to find initial endowments also give us total availability. Right? Because if WA1 plus WB1, so this is the sum of the initial endowments of A and B of good one, and that gives us the total availability. And the total availability, if it changes, then the length and breadth of our edgeward box will change, right? So if we talk about the length of this contract curve, then it will extend if the initial endowments increases. So we'll have a bigger edgeward box and we'll have a longer contract curve, okay? And if we ask that this question, that from the point E in the earlier diagram, at which point on this contract curve will we reach, then we will be able to answer the question. But just drawing a contract curve, it doesn't require the initial endowment. Given the two ICs, we can always find the points at which they will be tangent, and that will give us the equation for the contract curve. Okay. All right. So that separates the role of the ICs and the initial endowment in a given problem for us. Now, there are some other points about contract curve specifically that we must talk about. Number one is that from the start, we have talked about efficiency. We said that our equilibrium is defined in terms of efficiency. But when we are talking about sharing things, the idea of equity always comes in our mind. And for that, we must say that efficiency, or for that matter, Pareto efficiency, says nothing about equity. Now, by that, what we are saying is, that is because of this reason, OA and OB, given usual shape ICs here, they also belong to the contract curve. So OA and OB are also point on contract curve, and each of them are pretty exploitative in nature when you think of equity, because at OA, as you can see, or OB, one individual has everything and the other has nothing. So anything and nothing is a point on the contract curve. What it says is that if we look at the egalitarian structure and if we look at a dictatorship with exploitation, then from the idea of Pareto efficiency, or from the point of view of Pareto efficiency, both of them can be efficient. But obviously, one of them is not equitable at all. All right. So obviously, at this point, you may think that before, without making any progress, we must talk about equity because that's kind of needed. So in about equity, we'll talk about equity in welfare economics. But for the time being, in general equilibrium, we are interested in efficiency. Okay. The other thing, apart from this efficiency and equity, the other thing that we will talk about contract curve is that, you see, if we think about core, we found a lot of Pareto efficiency point within in which the utility of both of them are increasing. So we found Pareto improvements where utility of each of them are increasing. But on the contract curve, there is no such case. So utilities are in direct conflict. And that is because that is why, given efficiency argument, we cannot talk about equity. Given Pareto efficiency, we cannot really talk about equity, because if we move from M1 to M2, then this is not a Pareto improvement. So our discussion of efficiency ends on the contract curve. Okay. Beyond that is a part of welfare economics. All right. So now we will go to the mathematical structure of what we just did, and we'll see that the tangential condition that we found does come as a result of utility maximization problem. Okay, so first we will write the utility maximization problem that we have here. Now, we have shown that we can increase A's utility given a utility of B, and also we can increase B's utility given utility of A to find the room for Pareto improvement. So in our maximization problem, we will choose the maximization problem of B's utility. So the maximization problem we will choose here is that maximize XB1, XB2, utility of B, which depends on XB1, XB2, subject to three constraints. Number one is that the utility of A at least be maintained. And the other two are our old feasibility constraints. So for simplicity, we will just combine this in a single notation. Okay, so we have these three constraints. These are feasibility constraints, and this constraint come from the idea of Pareto improvement. Okay. Now, what I was saying is that you can alternatively write A here and solve A's problem given B's utility, and it will give the same result. Okay. So now if we combine these three constraints, then we'll get a single constraint. So alternatively, we can write this, that subject to U of A one minus XB1, right? So total availability minus the other person's consumption, and utility obtained from that will be the U bar. So we can erase these three constraints and we can just look at this one constraint, and we can solve the corresponding Lagrangian problem. Okay, so now if we solve the Lagrangian, and it's a standard problem of utility maximization. So you know how to do it. So what do? We construct the Lagrangian of this maximization problem, and then we simplify. So I'm just going to write the steps. So what do? We construct the Lagrangian, right? And then we'll go for the first order condition. So we'll go for the FOCs. Okay. And the FOCs yields the following. So what does it yield? Del u b, del x b1 equal to minus lambda del u a, del u x a1, and del u b, del u x b2. So this is for the first commodity, right? And for second, del u a, del x a2. Okay. And now, if we simply take a ratio, then what we achieve? We achieve mu x b1 divided by mu x b2 is equal to mu x a1 by mu x a2, which gives the result. So MRS A 1 comma 2, just MRS B 1 comma 2. So this is the condition of Pareto efficiency here, right? So this is our equilibrium condition here, or efficiency condition here. And at all the points where this condition is satisfied, we will call them Pareto efficient points. And as I said, that to arrive at this condition, we do not need endowments at all. In this condition, there is no omega 1 or omega 2. Okay, so without knowing the initial conditions, we have this equation of contract curve. So given a specific problem, this is the equation of contract curve. Now, apart from this, you can easily guess that such a condition can easily be extended for n number of consumers. So what is the result here? The result is that MRS must be same for all consumers who are involved in this exchange. But as I said earlier, that we have taken usual shape ICs, and with ICs convex to origin, there is a huge advantage. And the advantage is that if they are not tangent at some point, then obviously they will intersect and will immediately say that there is room for improvement. But this is not always the case. So in our diagram, since we have taken two very well behaved ICs, we have found what we call internal solutions. So we can have here also two types of solutions. Solutions which generally people call good solutions, which are internal solutions, and there can be corner solutions. Now, definitely, at corner solution, tangency condition does not hold. Tangency condition does not hold. That's quite trivial, right? So this condition does not hold when we have a corner solution, and we can have such corner solution if we deal with concave ICs or Leontief ICs, or obviously with lexicographic. Lastly, the one way that we can recognize such a corner solution or the point of difference is that at corners, at least one consumer will choose not to consume all the goods. Okay, so at corners, at least one consumer will choose not to consume all the goods. And obviously, it is because of this that we will have a corner solution. And you can imagine such a scenario in lexicographic preferences, because in lexicographic, the ordering depends first on at least one of the goods. And only if in two bundles, one of the goods which is lexicographically preferred, that good is of the same amount, then only the consumer will go to compare the amount of the other good. Okay, so obviously the way we will proceed is obviously from this simpler and easier and obviously this more, so to say, good and well-behaved condition that we have standard ICs and we have this efficiency condition satisfied in the Pareto efficient points, okay, which is the condition for exchange in consumption. And till this point, we have not discussed also the role of perfect competition, or we have not talked about market price. So in the next session, we will carry on keeping in mind that at Pareto efficient points, MRSs are equal for everybody. And then we will assume we will add the assumption of perfect competition. And then we'll see how to find the market prices. Okay.